Special welcome to all of you. Thank you for coming in this evening. Our Generation of Disciple program is really a program about families, and being able to recognize how important family is and how we come together as an individual family, but then as we have friends and neighbors, our families grow. As we have church, our families grow. Our school family, our families grow. It's all different levels and layers of families that we're celebrating. And how we do that is a way in which we too can know that that's the gift, that's what we can offer to other people. Our love, our friendship, our caring for each other, whether you're in the workplace or in our homes or trying to get some gas in the car and crying a little bit when you're filling up the gas. As somebody said earlier, it's like, it's hard to cry when we watch something happening to families on the other side of the world in Ukraine. It's hard to complain about situations when we know other people in the world have, you know, just trying to get some dinner on the table tonight. So let's take a moment to pray a little bit and ask this evening that we can broaden our perspective of it is about us. We need to take care of ourselves, but it's also about a lot of other families, a lot of other situations, companies, and employees in the world that need our prayers and help as well. So as we begin this evening, just taking opportunity in this opening prayer time to ask God for his blessings on this evening, to open our eyes and ears to what God has for us this evening and what Carolyn has for us this evening.
Give the children back their childhood. Let the children run and play. Don't make them fight your battles. They're the ones who always seem to pay. Don't make battlefields of their playground. Don't barricade their streets, or they'll grow up too soon, and they won't grow up complete. You can raise them on your hatred, revel in it, that's your right. But if you do, just remember, it'll haunt their sleep at night. A little mommy feeds her baby, giving all the love she knows. A tiny builder's building bridges to the world in which he's going to grow.
God rests on the seventh day.
God settles man in the Garden of Eden to cultivate and care for it.
The Sabbath day is for everyone. All are allowed to rest from their work.
The Lord blesses our work so that we may share its fruits with others.
Do not withhold wages from your workers, for their livelihood depends on them.
To deprive an employee of wages is to commit murder.
To observe religious practices but oppress your workers is false worship.
Woe to him who treats his workers unjustly.
All workers should be paid a just and living wage.
The Sabbath was made for people, not people for the Sabbath.
Practice integrity in your work.
One's worth is not determined by an abundance of possessions.
And whatever you do, in word and deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him.
Truly, I say to you, as you did it to me, did it to one of the least of these, my brothers or sisters, you did it to me.
Those verses that you just heard were actually scripture verses from both the Old and the New Testament. And tonight we'd like you to take just a few minutes in your family to talk about a few questions that we'll have up on the screen. So take a minute or two and discuss them together.
Why don't we all stand and sing this peace song, Let There Be Peace on Earth.
Thank you. Please be seated. I don't know if you remember me, but I was here in September, and my name is Pope Leo XIII. I'm kind of old. I was born in 1810. That makes me a little old. But I became Pope in 1878. And I was Pope for almost the longest of any Pope, because I was Pope till 1903. And I have to tell you, it breaks my heart to see the images of the Ukrainian children and their families, violence, the war-torn country, all that's happening in a land that's very, very dear to my heart. So when you go home tonight, do Pope Leo a favor. Say a prayer for those children and the families, the moms, dads, the people who are affected by that war. So back in 1891, which is a long time ago, were you born in 1891? Were you alive in 1891? I don't think so. Was anybody here born in before 1891? Not 1991. I don't think so. 1891's a long time ago. But when I was in Rome, where I lived, I looked out at my apartment and I saw factories. Factories that had just really came into their being in the 1800s. And the thing about those factories was that they had big smokestacks that billowed out lots of smoke all over Italy, all over Rome. And they had lots of people in those factories who made lots of things. But the thing is that the people who worked in those factories worked for a really long time. Many, many, many hours. Sometimes 20 hours a day. If you do the math, and I know you're all good at math, I'm not so good at math. As a Pope, I went into religion, not into math, and you know, man. But if you did the math, 24 hours in a day, and if you're going to work 20 of them, that's a lot of hours, 4 hours of sleep. That's not good. The conditions were not good. And the conditions were not good for the people who worked there in terms of their safety. So in those factories, there were people who would lose their lives. They'd lose some limbs. They would get hurt because it was dangerous, dangerous work. And what really broke my heart as a Pope was that I saw little children, like some of you, children working in those factories for many, many hours in the day for hardly any pay. I don't know how much you make for, like, you know, mowing a lawn, or shoveling a sidewalk, or some of the things you might do, but those children made very, very little pay. They worked in very difficult conditions, worked a lot of hours, and made a little bit of pay. So I looked at that, and I said, I have to do something. The church has to do something about that. And so I sat down in 1891, and I wrote a letter to the church. And I called it, that's a big word. I speak Italian and I'm really fluent, so I just want you to know that. We can have a conversation later. But I called it Rerum Novarum, which, like, in English, which I also speak, because, you know, I speak lots of languages. In English, that stands for on the condition of labor. And what I did in that letter to you, to the church, is that I spoke to the conditions of the people who are working in those factories. And I said, the church, we all need to do something about this. We need to say something about this. We need to make positive changes. And that's what happened. Little by little, the conditions in the factories improved, and the church had something to do with that. That was the beginning of what you've been talking about all year. Catholic social teaching, the first letter that was written to the church about a social issue, an issue that was affecting people's lives. And then other letters are written by other popes and other bishops and other church leaders. And we put that all together, we have what we've been studying all year, Catholic social teaching. But it started with this. It's not up there anymore. It started with the rights of workers and the dignity of work. That's the first issue that we tackled with Catholic social teaching. I want to show you a video that gives you a little bit of a summary about this particular principle of Catholic social teaching, the rights of workers and the dignity of work. It's called CST 101. It means it's really basic. We're all going to get something from this, right? But listen to the people talk and watch the art that's created right before your very eyes when you watch this video. Is my hat in anybody's way?
For us as believers, the dignity of work comes out of a whole theology of creation. In Genesis, we see that God has made creation and entrusted to us the continuation of his work.
Work is God's gift to us. We're able to use the different gifts that God has given us, physical gifts, spiritual, mental gifts, to make the world a better place.
Because the church recognizes that every person is created in God's image and likeness and therefore has inherent dignity, we also recognize that work exists for people. People don't exist for work. So recognizing the rights of workers is one of the ways that we honor the dignity of every person.
Among the things that we need to uphold are the just wage, safe working conditions, and the possibility of the worker to participate in the fruits of his labor.
Catholic teaching holds that workers have the right to dignified work, as well as to time for leisure and rest, and they have the right to benefits such as sick leave and maternity leave and paternity leave and health care. Workers have a right to adequate support in their retirement and also to choose to form unions if that's what they'd like to do. Catholic teaching also holds that workers have responsibilities. They have the responsibility to provide a fair day's work for a fair day's wage. Managers and supervisors and employers can make decisions in their workplaces that uphold the rights of workers, that provide decent wages and a safe working environment.
We have situations here, right in here in our neighborhood, where we've seen people that were not employable. And the best thing is when they can get back on their feet with the help of church and our diocesan programs that will help them find a job with meaning. All of a sudden the neighborhood gets better, they feel great about themselves, and there's a harmony that's created that really shows the dignity of work.
Sometimes it can be easy to forget the workers who are involved in producing the goods that we consume, so it can be helpful to think back. If you take a cup of coffee, thinking all the way back through the roasters and to the farmers who actually grew the beans, there are many workers in that process, and our decisions impact them.
It's important that our people be informed about the different issues around work in our society and try to promote just laws and talk to people about the importance of respecting workers' rights.
As consumers, we need to be aware that really every purchasing decision is a moral decision. We can purchase ethically produced products or fair trade products. We can purchase locally and support local farmers, for example.
All Catholics need to be aware that this is part of the way that we live our life of discipleship, by promoting human dignity, defending the workers' rights, and looking for ways to make our society more attentive to the needs of those who are most vulnerable.
Mickey McGrath only 3.5 minutes to make that a piece of work. That artwork is amazing. The dignity of work and the rights of workers. Everybody should have a job. It's in working that we feel we have gifts, we have talents to share. And shouldn't everybody be able to do that? So tonight we're going to look at a couple of issues that deal with the things we buy that affect the people that make them. We'll talk a little bit more about that later. But I met a young boy in Canada. He's a Packer fan. You'll notice in the video he's a Packer fan. Just, you know, that's good. I'm a Packer fan. They have a G on the side of their helmet. I think it stands for God, I think. Anyway, this young boy in Canada, his name was Craig Kielberger. And when he was, you'll hear the story, but when he was only about 12 years old, he read a story in the newspaper about another young boy in Pakistan who was killed for speaking up about the rights of children. Children who were working. And Craig, up in Canada with his little friends, reading the comics and doing whatever they did up there, playing football, trying to be Aaron Rodgers, they got together and decided to do something about the children who were affected by working conditions across the world. So they formed this organization called Free the Children. And Free the Children became a worldwide movement and organization that spoke for children's rights. Craig is now 30-some years old. But as a 12-year-old, his heart was touched. His mind was touched that he could do something for the children who are being misused and abused in factories, in bad working conditions around the world. I want to show you Craig Kielberger's story. And I'm going to go pray for the children.
Who is this 14-year-old boy? And what could he have possibly done at such a young age to be receiving an International Human Rights Award? His name is Craig Kielberger, and his story is a stirring example of what one person can do to fight unfairness and injustice.
Over the past year, I've had the opportunity to travel through 5 countries in South Asia, and I've met many children who are suffering. Children who are living on the streets of some of the world's largest cities. I've met children sold as bonded laborers, working 12 to 16 hours a day in the carpet industry. These children have no vote, no voice, and no political clout. Many of them are subjected to some of the most inhumane forms of exploitation. And today I am here to speak for these children.
Craig's story began 2 years earlier when he read a newspaper article about a Pakistani boy named Iqbal Masih. Iqbal had been sold into slavery in the carpet industry at age 4 to pay off his family's $12 debt. When he was finally freed 6 years later, he began speaking out against the abuses of child labor. At the age of 12, he was murdered.
I was also 12 years old at that point, and I had never heard about child labor. I did not know where Pakistan was on the world map, and I certainly knew nothing about the world in which millions of children my age work long hours in conditions approaching slavery each day. And my question is, are all children created equal? And if child labor is wrong for a white, middle-class child in North America, then why is it any different for a girl in Thailand or a boy in Brazil? My friends and I have started an organization called Free the Children, a youth group mainly made up of young people between 10 and 16 years of age. And the purpose of our group is not only to free children from exploitation and abuse, but also to free children from the idea that they are powerless and that they have no role to play in today's society.
Free the Children, how may I help you? Craig Kuhlberger speaking.
Using Craig's house as its headquarters, Free the Children set out with the goal of eradicating the exploitation and abuse of children throughout the world.
Oh yeah, we have many projects. For example, today we're just working with our petition we started.
Free the Children sent this 10,000 name petition to world leaders urging them to end unfair child labor practices. And they use every opportunity to speak out against child labor at schools, churches, service groups, anywhere people will listen.
We have a couple of special guests coming in today to talk to you about a new organization that they've organized.
We've come to talk to you about a problem that we find very serious, and it is child labor. Factory owners just love to hire children because they don't have to pay them as much. They're easily intimidated, won't fight or talk back, and they cannot form trade unions.
As their activities increased, so did their reputation. And then, just a few months after their conception, the Ontario Federation of Labour invited Craig to speak to the 2,000 delegates at its convention in Toronto.
Children in dangerous glass factories. Children in the sugarcane fields. Children physically and verbally abused. Children making the many products which we import into Canada and use every day without considering their source. Who will help the children if we don't? Thank you very much.
Anyway, I just wanted to let you know that the board has just voted and will donate $5,000 to your cause. And by way of that, we are now challenging everybody out there to help Craig. You said you needed $10,000?
Yes, that's what we're hoping to raise for a fight.
Okay, well, I think we can do better than that. Okay?
We would like to donate $5,000.
We'd like to donate
$1,000. Yeah, we're going to match the $5,000.
Sure.
When the final tally was in, Craig had raised $150,000 to be used for projects that would directly help exploited working children of the developing world. Giving speeches was one thing, but traveling to Asia was quite another. So how does a 12-year-old convince his parents to let him travel halfway around the world to investigate the abuses of child labor? For Craig, the key was Alam, a trusted friend of the family with relatives in Bangladesh. Alam agreed to serve as Craig's guide and guardian. He would also videotape the trip.
We're heading in to go see a domestic servant now.
In India, Craig found this young girl working 11 hours a day, pulling apart used hospital syringes for recycling. She used to go to school, but stopped because of the poverty in her family.
It's quite dangerous if you prick yourself with the spread of so many diseases lately.
I was literally in shock. She was wearing no shoes and no gloves. And the needle tips were uncovered, yet she just considers it life.
We had
had to leave before we could get out all of her questions because the person, our guide with us, says that if her boss sees us talking to us, he might hit her as he has done before.
In Pakistan, Craig visited a brick kiln where poor families had borrowed small amounts of money from the kiln owner, and now their children work as bonded laborers to pay off the debt. These children make bricks 12 hours a day, 7 days a week, and never leave the kiln. The cost of their food and board is deducted from their tiny wages, so most of these children will work here their entire lives and never get out of debt.
He does not know what a school is
no.
at all. Has he ever been off the brick kiln?
No, he has never been outside.
He's never been outside this complex.
When we see a child suffering, you should feel deep down in your stomach a feeling that begins to build. And once that happens, once our eyes are open, that's when we're truly responsible to take action.
Craig's trip to Asia and the media attention it got triggered a bombshell of activity. Free the Children chapters sprung up everywhere as thousands of kids were drawn into this international network of children helping children. And their impact is enormous. They send badly needed school supplies and health kits to children who are too poor to buy them. Through garage sales and car washes, they raise money for teacher salaries in schools that are otherwise too poor to hire them. And that $150,000 Craig got from the Ontario Federation of Labor helped build this rehabilitation and education center for children freed from labor in India.
People will sometimes look at me and say, well, you know, you're only 13 years old. And well, 13-year-olds, they don't do these type of things. As young people, we are capable of doing more than simply watching TV, playing video games, hanging around malls. No, don't get me wrong, I actually do these things, and I love doing them too. You know what, there's so much more on top of this that young people can do. You know, some of you may say, well, I can't do great things. Well, Mother Teresa once said that we could do no great things. We could only do small things with great love. And if everyone around the world were willing to open their eyes and open their hearts, then there would be no more poverty, there would be no more injustice, and there would be no more abuse. And that is the challenge which we all must face. Through your words and through your actions, set these children free. Thank you.
Quite a story for a 12-year-old. I heard there was a Pope here earlier.
Yes.
I missed him.
Nice guy.
I think I missed him every time he's come here. Right here at Resurrection Parish, a Pope. Wow. That's amazing. Oh, yeah? What was different? Oh, you have to ask him next time he's here. So, Craig Kielberger, 12 years old. Working with issues that are pretty heavy, right? So tonight we're going to look at two particular issues that affect everyone. One is we all wear clothes, right? We all have these clothes on. And these clothes that we wear come from different countries and different places and different made by different people. And so we're going to look at that. And then we're going to look at chocolate. Who likes chocolate? Easter's coming in a while. I gave up this stuff right now, so I'd love some chocolate tonight. But chocolate. We're going to look at chocolate and how chocolate's made and what's the process with that. So tonight, to get into that first issue of clothing, we have just a short little, like, two and a half minute video to just get you into the topic about how sometimes the clothes that we wear are made right in our area. Sometimes the clothing that we wear is made somewhere else in the United States.
But sometimes the clothing we wear is made in some other country, and sometimes by little children. So we're going to watch this two and a half minute video, and it's called The Clothes on Your Back. So give it a look.
In buildings like this Riverside factory in old Dhaka, there's ample evidence that Bangladeshi children continue to stitch and sew shirts and pants at all hours of the day and night. It's easy here to find kids 11 or 12 years old making garments. In fact, when colleague Ravina Alak worked undercover, her manager was 9. In Tamina Embroidery, preteen boys and girls oversee industrial-sized machines that stitch shalwar kameez embroidered with floral and other intricate patterns. Many work from 9 in the morning until 9 at night. Up one floor in AT Apparels, a group of young workers uses glue to fix shiny sequins on dresses just in time for Eid. The workers say they are happy to be working. Many kids come to Dhaka from rural Bangladesh, where schooling isn't an option. Kitty Corner from the dock where workers boat across the Buriganga River every morning before their shifts in garment factories, another open-air factory. Boys aged 11 and 12 work non-stop all day, stitching golf shirts and other garments for local wholesalers. At the end of each workday, some don't bother going home. They sleep at their workstations. Shaquille Khan is 10 years old and has been at work for more than 12 hours. He's from Chandpur and has been in Dhaka for 4 months. He gets room and board. Khan is diligent with his work. In a 12-hour shift, he handles more than 1,400 shirts. He is not alone. Through the maze of streets of old Dhaka, every factory has workers. Children, just like him.
As we go through this piece on clothing, I just wanted to make sure that we're aware that this isn't meant to, you know, make people feel guilty. It's more of an awareness piece, right? We all have to wear clothes. Not all of our clothes can come from Northeast Wisconsin. The reality is they come from different parts of the world. But just to be aware of the fact that some are made in other parts of the world, and sometimes the conditions that they're made isn't the best. We're going to have a fashion show. A fashion show.
So could our models come up and line up over here, please?
I've been waiting for this all day long.
Welcome to our fashion show. We have a real treat for you today. In just a few minutes, you'll get a chance to see our models displaying some of the hottest fashion trends today.
This show isn't all about looking good, though. Today, we will be taking you behind the scenes of your favorite brands. We're going to be looking at something the big clothing companies don't want you to know about, the truth about the conditions under which our clothes are made. Sometimes they're made in sweatshops. Sweatshops, places that, as I think the Pope probably explained a little bit, conditions are hard. Conditions are difficult, sometimes dangerous. Hot, long hours, little pay, that's a sweatshop. So please, get comfortable, listen well, because you don't want to miss a moment of our upcoming presentation.
Our first model is wearing the latest apparel from one of our largest retailers of casual apparel and accessories, Aeropostale. This specialty retailer has high-quality denim offered at compelling values in an innovative and exciting store environment. Aeropostale embraces acceptance, empathy, and respect to promote a sense of unity.
Wait a minute. Acceptance, empathy, respect.
That's what I said.
Not to my knowledge. Aeropostale is known to use sweatshops for making their clothing items. It's also been involved in child labor scandals. Most of their production factories are in Asia and Central America, in countries like Sri Lanka and Vietnam. Even if they claim to defend human rights, they're still sending children to work on cotton farms.
Well, our next model is wearing the Disney athletic wear. Disney carries men's, women's, and children's trendy clothing with your favorite Disney characters. What's not to love about Disney?
The Disney, Walt Disney Company, also known as Disney, makes their clothing in sweatshops using child labor. Disney breaches local labor laws, oppresses Chinese workers, and forces staff to do three times the amount of work they should be doing.
Our next model is wearing a trendy outfit from The Gap, a favorite shopping destination of many people.
For many years, Gap was infamous for its sweatshop abuses. After more than 10 years of campaigns and actions by students like Craig Kielberger and concerned citizens, Gap has begun to change its ways. They still have a long way to go. The International Labor Organization, a UN initiative, states that the minimum age that someone can be employed at is 15, yet the Gap factories still employ 14-year-olds.
Doesn't our next model look great? And you'd never guess how much she saved by buying her outfit at Walmart.
The reason Walmart's able to keep the prices so low is that they pay as little as they can to the people making their products. Workers making products for Walmart are located in China and Bangladesh, as we saw on the film, and have been paid as little as 17 cents an hour.
Our next model is kicking it with these Nike designs. From head to toe, Nike has all the right styles for on and off the court.
Nike has spent many years as the poster child of sweatshops. They've been accused of practicing child labor many times over the years. They have used many unethical practices to become the top-selling activewear brand in the world. Nike created a culture of discrimination and sexual harassment, and they didn't feel responsible for the human rights violations happening daily in their factories. Pressure and constant campaigning by people all over the world has forced Nike to take on a great deal of initiative when it comes to labor rights in recent years. They're far from perfect, but in 2005, Nike set a great example by being the first major retailer to disclose a full list of the factories where their products are produced. So we're not asking you to boycott any of the products shown in the fashion show tonight. We don't advocate boycotts unless the infected workers request us to act, or in exceptional circumstances when countries are determined to be systematic violators of worker and human rights. We're asking that you support the efforts of garment, toy, and shoe workers around the world to improve their wages and working conditions, just like Craig Kielberger did. So one of the things, if you and your family start to Google some of these companies, you'll see and learn quite a bit.
At this time, we're going to ask you as a family to look at your clothing that you are wearing today. Where were they made? What will you as a family do about these unfair labor practices? So take a peek. Let's check see where your, those clothing.
Check out your labels on your shirts, your jackets, your shoes. Stink up the church a little bit.
Morning.
forget to look at those shoe labels. So, let's hear some of the countries that you found on your clothes. What do you got? China? What do you have? China as well. Mexico? Yes. China? A lot of China. Bangladesh? Yes. Cambodia? Mm-hmm. Vietnam? Way in the back. Yes, you. India? Okay. Nice loud voices. That's really cool. I can hear it even with, you know, my old ears. Yeah. Egypt, really interesting. Yes. The Philippines and China. Any others? You haven't heard yet? Sri Lanka. Okay, yes. Where? Peru. Okay, yes. Nicaragua. Any others we missed? That's a lot of countries, right? And in some of those countries, the people are being treated well, being paid a fair wage, the working conditions are okay, and they're doing all right. In some other countries, maybe not so much. And that's kind of one of our roles, like the Pope would say, to educate ourselves to figure out what's the difference, right? What's the difference? What countries do better with that, and which countries don't do so well? Carolyn, anything more to say about that? Oh, we're just rolling right along. Oh, you're down there already. Okay. All right. Yes. Why are clothes not made in the U.S.? It's a really good question. Some clothes are, right? Some clothes are made in the U.S. You probably want to Google that, like what clothes are made in the U.S. when you get home, okay? But why do you think clothes sometimes are not made in the U.S.? What would be a reason for that? What do you think? Cost, right? What do you think? What? Italy, that's another country. The cost, right? So to make something in the United States right now, our minimum wage, you know, is under $10, but most over COVID-19, most employers are paying, you know, usually a minimum of about $15 an hour. Remember the cost that, do you remember what people were making in one of those countries? I named it earlier. It was like under a dollar. Do you remember what the figure was? 17 cents an hour, right? So if you're making 17 cents an hour in some country, in some sweatshop, some factory in, let's just say, Sri Lanka, and then we come to the United States and you're making $15 an hour, almost 10 times the amount, that's a big difference. So what happens? Your clothes have to cost more. And if your clothes cost more, that means the people who make them, if it costs more to make, they don't make as much, right? There's not enough, as much profit. And therefore, they a lot of times send the making of the clothes somewhere else where they can do it cheaper. So that's why, Father Tom, that happens. Any other questions about that? Otherwise, we're gonna shift to something really sweet. It's a really sweet topic. Chocolate. All right. Chocolate. One thing I want you to realize before we get into this topic of chocolate is what fair trade is all about. You might hear fair trade coffee, fair trade chocolate, fair trade other products. There's four things, if you can remember these as best you can as you go home, four things that make something fair trade, okay, four things. One, the farmers and the workers receive wages that allow them to live well enough to lift themselves out of poverty and have safe working environments, right? So they make enough to not live in poverty. That would be a product that's fair trade. Secondly, children are not allowed to work in a fair trade situation, right? So if a product, if the coffee you drink or the chocolate you eat is called fair trade, that means a child has not made that. It'd be a certain age, right? And I think we heard the age for the UN has kind of set is at a minimum 15 years old. All right. Third, chocolate farmers paid additional funds to invest in community development. So the people who make the grow the chocolate, they invest in the community. That makes it fair trade. So they don't just take all the profits and go home and live a nice life. They put the profits back into the community and make the community better for everybody to live. And then lastly, what makes something fair trade is that farming villages become better, what we call stewards of the environment. They help the environment. They take care of the environment. So they use practices that, and the way they make something is that they help the environment. They don't tear down the environment, right? So that would make something fair trade. So those four things. And if those four things are present, something could be called fair trade. If they're not, if they're using children to make the product, or they tear apart the environment as they make the product, or any of those other things, then it's not fair trade, all right? So we're gonna watch a little video. It's called The Dark Side of Chocolate. The Dark Side of Chocolate. Anybody like dark chocolate? Okay, a little play on words here, right? But this is the dark side of chocolate, not dark chocolate. I like milk chocolate better, but anyway, that's beside the point. The dark side of chocolate. Let's watch this short little video and see what this has to tell us.
Good evening and welcome to 16 by 9, The Bigger Picture. I'm Carolyn Jarvis. It's the most sacred day in the Christian calendar, and in today's world, a commercial blitz. Easter, a time for the chocolate industry to cash in. But what many may not realize when they're getting their chocolate fix this year is just who's behind it. Kids, some as young as 10, are fueling a child labor movement in the cocoa fields of Western Africa. Our Catherine Pope takes us to Ghana with a look at the darker side of chocolate.
Children in Canada love eating chocolate. But while they indulge in this sweet treat, some children who have never tasted chocolate are forced to work on cocoa bean farms in West Africa.
It's very sweet.
Chocolate is made from cocoa beans, which grow in pods on trees.
You have some beans in it, counting about 50 to 60 beans. You can eat it like toffee. But the rare bean, if I bite it, it's very bitter.
Cocoa beans are Ghana's biggest cash crop, but it's a bittersweet harvest because of the common use of child labor. Ghana's Gold Coast, as it used to be known, was once the center of West Africa's slave trade. In some ways, the practice continues. To find the children of the cocoa bean, we drove hundreds of kilometers down bumpy, almost impassable roads. And trekked deep into the heart of the cocoa region. This teenager says he's been toiling at this every day since he was 13. BK is just 9 years old. He spends 8 hours a day working the cocoa beans. The use of child labor and the trafficking of children to work on the cocoa bean farms is a problem the government is struggling to deal with. Matthew Daly investigates child trafficking.
Conditions generally are bad for them. It's generally bad for them. They work under very harsh conditions, under very terrible environments. Some are beaten up.
Everywhere we went, children told us stories about abusive labor conditions. He said his mother wouldn't feed him unless he worked. This little girl's job was to spray the cocoa with insecticides.
At what age did she start working in the cocoa bean farm?
9 years.
13 years
now.
This boy worked 7 days a week, tending the cocoa pod.
He was weeding, he used to weed.
In this part of the world, even the wealthiest cocoa bean farmer makes less than $500 per year. They live in small huts with large families. There is no electricity, running water, or sewer systems. Elementary school is free, but some parents force their children to work instead.
Why were your children working on the cocoa bean farm?
Because I was not having money.
Is that wrong to use children on the cocoa bean farm?
Yes.
You think so?
Yes.
But you needed the money.
Yes.
The big chocolate companies say they're doing their part to help conditions for children working on the cocoa farms. But only one, Cadbury, has promised to use fair trade cocoa in one of its candy bars. And none were available for an on-camera interview with 16x9. Even more disturbing is the buying and selling of children. Traffickers sometimes pay parents for their child, then move them onto the cocoa bean farms. Child labor is not uncommon in Ghana. This six-year-old works 12 hours a day selling water.
How much? Say? 100 cedis.
She'll make about 40 cents by sunset. This boy works 7 days a week sifting for gold.
How much could a child potentially be bought for?
On the average, about 200,000 cedis.
Which is about?
$20 thereabouts.
But the Ghanaian government is under pressure to rid the cocoa bean farms of child labor because Westerners are huge consumers of chocolate. So they're trying to get the kids off the farms and into school. The government pays for the children's uniforms and books. Their parents given groceries to compensate them for the loss of the child labor. And for the first time, they're allowed to play, a freedom some never had because they were too busy working the cocoa beans. Rita Damoa of the Farmers Union believes children must be educated, not forced to work.
It means we are denying the children that of going to school. So it's bad. It means it will affect the child in future.
Farmers are starting to realize the benefits of fair trade. If they join the union, they get a guaranteed fair price for their beans. Child labor is not allowed, and the profits go back into the community. Fair trade beans paid for this water pump, providing clean, fresh drinking water for everyone, a luxury this village has never been able to afford. And other equipment, like this small corn mill, have been purchased with the profits from fair trade, so people are getting better nutrition. The Farmers Union is trying to encourage chocolate brokers to buy more of it.
What would you like people who eat chocolate in Canada to know?
I just want people in Canada to go in for fair trade chocolate, because just a bite of the chocolate, as I've said, has a greater impact on the lives of the people over here. So they should go in for the fair trade produce, and that will help us a lot.
In Canada, fair trade chocolate is regulated by transfer. Michael Zellmer says buying fair trade makes a huge difference.
That means that they won't be forced to work on farms, which is a problem that's endemic in Western Africa. There's a lot of child slavery on cocoa farms and just child labor in general. And so with the fair trade certification standards, you're not allowed to have, well, certainly there's no forced labor, and then labor of children under 15 years of age is also controlled. Essentially, it's that it cannot prevent them from going to school, it can't do anything that will affect their life chances. It's also important because it ensures that their families get paid a decent price for their labor. And fair trade certified cocoa comes entirely from democratically run cooperatives of small scale producers.
That will triple the amount of fair trade chocolate produced in Guyana. But in a country saddled with crushing poverty, the use of child labor is endemic. And that's a problem Canadian children will never get a taste of.
Carolyn, did you catch that? There were two popes here tonight. There's Pope Leo, and then the reporter's name was Catherine Pope. Did you see that? Pretty cool, huh?
Two popes.
Hey, do we get to taste some chocolate?
We do. So tonight, we're going to let you taste some fair trade chocolate. Now, it's going to taste a little different than what you're used to, but this chocolate is actually made, as they said, in locations where children are not part of those factories and the workers are paid well, etc. So it's important that we pay attention to what we purchase, whether it's coffee, it's chocolate, it's our clothing, right? So I'm going to come around and share that with you, but as we do, maybe you could talk as a family about what's something you could do this Easter to help this situation out a little bit. Now, you're not going to solve the problem overnight, but what's something your family could do for Easter to help with this whole situation? So I'm going to come around with chocolate for you to try.
Remember, rubies don't get chocolate. No feeding the dog. Ruby the dog. Father Tom said, feed the owner, Father Tom, not his dog. So that's probably a wise idea. You're giving candy to children right before bedtime, always a good practice, right? I'll be back. All right, so I'm just curious, as you're eating this fair trade chocolate, what do you think? Hershey's, fair trade. No, I gave it up for a while. You liking it? Fair trade? Thumbs up. Look at that. Lots of thumbs up. There you go. So check out, where did you get this, Carolyn?
Oh, good question. So I know Costco carries it. I know Walmart carries it. I know Target carries it. I would think most of our local companies will carry it. It's also available online through Amazon. This includes clothing. It includes coffee. It includes candies, jewelry. There's all kinds of things. So just check it out online on things you can do to help the trade market. So did you come up with an idea of what you can do this Easter? What did you guys come up with? Oh, buy more peeps. There you go. So just keep it in mind as you move toward the Easter season. We have a few announcements for you tonight. One of the things that we're going to do during this Lenten season is to do a couple of collections. So one of the collections that we're going to do is collecting, you know those little Easter eggs, those plastic ones that you can put candy in and use it for an Easter egg hunt? We are going to partner with the Parish St. Anthony's in Neopit. It's a community that doesn't always get opportunities like an egg hunt. So we thought it would be nice if Resurrection Parish would provide the supplies for the children in Neopit to have an Easter egg hunt. So one of the things we're asking of you is for you to consider purchasing or bringing in even used eggs that you might have from Easter egg hunts in the past, and then any type of candy that is individually wrapped. And we're going to put that all together, and we're going to send it off to Neopit so the children there can enjoy an Easter egg hunt. So something to consider. Those supplies can be brought here to the parish. We'll have boxes at the entrances, or can go to the parish office, either way. In addition to that collection, we are doing a collection, as you know, for Freedom House. And those supplies that they're looking for are actually listed in the, I believe, in the bulletin and parish website, so you can check out those spots for the items that are needed. We're also looking for a few people to help out with some service projects at the Freedom House. So they're looking for people to help with children's games, with cleaning, with sorting supplies, any of that kind of thing. If you're interested, please see Tony. There's going to be two different dates that they're going to go to Freedom House, and they're looking for some help. So if you're interested in helping with children's games, cleaning, or sorting, please see Tony. In addition to that, this is something you could do as family. They're doing a 40 in 40. So what you're going to do is either do a walk or a run. And for each mile that you walk or run, a donation then gets made to the Freedom House. You can sign up to do this on the parish website again, or see Tony and he can direct you further. In addition to that, another option you have, of course, is the rice bowl. Those rice bowls are available at each of the entrances to the church if you haven't already gotten one. The monies that are collected from there are going to be used to help people from all over the world with issues of hunger, malnutrition, starting up life again, right? So those rice bowls are at each of the entrances for you. In addition to that, I have on your clipboard on the newsletter is a list of all the different things happening here in the parish during the Lenten season. Consider stepping into the church and joining us for one or two of them, if not more, and really make this Lenten journey a special journey for you and your family as we head to Easter. As we close, I have a closing prayer for you. Gracious and merciful God, we pray today for the Ukrainian people and all victims of war and oppression, and ask for your intervention in this senseless war levied against them by Russia. We pray, O God, for protection, that there will be peace. We pray for restoration and renewed hope. We pray for families, especially the children, living through the horrors of war and all the upheaval and tribulation it brings. We also pray for those protesting in Russia against these violent acts by their government. We ask you to protect them and keep these protesters as they put their bodies on the line in the name of what is just and right. We pray for the entire world community, including the leaders of our own country. Give them wisdom and ingenuity to respond in ways that end this war and moves us all to a world where your peace abides. Hear the cries of your people, O God. Have mercy on us, and have mercy on the people of the world. Amen. We thank you for joining us tonight. Our next session will be in April, and I apologize, I don't have the date on the top of my tongue, but we will see you next month. In the meantime, see what you can do to help out the situation. Take care.